Good evening to you all. Obviously, we've gotten a conversation started already, which is good news for Laura and Alice, I think, as we go forward. My name is Bea Banyu, and I'm chair of the Food Studies program at the New School. We're sponsoring this event. We're very happy to have you and welcome you. I'm just going to start, because we always start with a little ad for Food Studies, to tell you a little bit about our program. We offer degrees in food studies, BA, BS, and AAS degrees. But we also offer a lot of classes that are open to the public. There'll be a variety of them in each particular semester. You should look for them in the CE catalog. If you're a degree student, obviously you'll find them in our regular course catalog. We do a bunch of different programs, most of which are free and available to everyone. There are some, like our conferences, which happen generally in late spring. This year it will be April 28th and 29th, and we're doing a conference on zero food waste, which turns out to be a very hot topic in the food world right now. So look for more information on the website about that event as we plan it out and plot it out. There will be more and more information. If you are at all interested in any of our events, you should just feel free to go out to the table that was the sign-in table and put your name down on the list, and they'll include you on our listserv, so you'll get all the information about our public programming. In fact, tomorrow we actually have a program that we're running in room 406 of this building, so right downstairs. We've been having a series of classes, but there are also lectures open to the public on food insecurity, primarily because we found out that when they did a survey of our students here at the New School, there was a considerable amount of students who were food insecure, meaning that there were times of the month where they didn't know where the next meal was going to come from. They didn't have the funds to manage to eat on a regular basis at certain times during the school year. So we brought in speakers from the Food Bank of New York City. And tomorrow at 6 o'clock, from 6 to 7:40, the same format as this evening, Rachel Sabella, the Director of Government Relations, and Emmanuel Negron, Director of Benefits Access, will be talking about government programs to address food insecurity. They're a font of information, the people from the food bank. So any and all of you are welcome to attend. Again, it's in room 407, sorry, in this building right downstairs. And anyway, no further ado, we'll get into our program, and let me introduce Alice Crary, who will be talking to Laura tonight, and she'll introduce Laura. Alice is an American philosopher who is also the chair of our Department of Philosophy in the graduate faculty and co-chair of Gender and Sexuality Studies here in the program for the New School for Social Research. She is well known for her numerous scholarly works on the moral dimensions of language, as well as edited collections of Wittgenstein, Cora Diamond, and Stanley Cavell. Alice is the author of two monographs on ethics, Beyond Moral Judgment and Inside Ethics, on the demands of moral thought. While still finishing her doctorate in philosophy in the University of Pittsburgh, she co-edited and wrote the introduction to The New Wittgenstein, which continues to influence debates over Wittgenstein's philosophy. Currently, she is associate professor of philosophy at the New School for Social Research. She has been a Humboldt Foundation scholar in 2009 and 10 at the Goethe University in Frankfurt, a Rockefeller fellow in 2003 and 4 at Princeton University, and has been invited speaker at such venues as the Society of Fellows in the Humanities at Columbia University, the Center for Philosophy, Art, and Literature at Duke University, Collegiate College, and Brooklyn Public Philosophers in New York City. So I will now pass this on to Alice so she can take, and by the way, Please, there'll be a chance for Q&A at the end. We don't have a handheld mic to pass around. We are recording this. So if you'd just go up to ask your questions, because we want to make sure that all of the questions, which we're expecting to be quite interesting, will be recorded on the mic. So when you have a question later on, just go up. Anyway, thank you very much and welcome.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, one of the other things is the book will be on sale at the end of the program. All you have to do is talk to Laura.
Okay, I'm going to introduce Laura, and my style of introductions isn't typically to go over distinctions, so I feel like I'd really like attention focused on her groundbreaking book, The Vegan Studies Project, Food, Animals, and Gender in the Age of Terror. And I'm going to tell you just a little bit about her, partly because she's a really wide-ranging scholar and activist, and some of the other features of her background might be of interest when we open the floor and you want to ask her questions. So before we talk about her book, which is absolutely fascinating, I just want to mention that she's the author of a number of other books, including three monographs. One of them is on the novelist J.M. Coetzee. It's called Writing Out of All the Camps. That was in 2006. She has another one on the environment in post-colonial called Wilderness into Civilized Shapes. And she has another volume on post-colonial studies in film called Visual Difference. Those two, she was incredibly prolific, 2010 and 2011. And she has another edited volume on Coetzee from 2014. So you get a sense of some of the range of her interests. What we're going to do together here is talk about her book in a way that I hope to draw her out so that you really can get a feel for it, even if you haven't read it, and so you'll be encouraged to read it and enjoy it. If you have read the book, you'll know that some of her other interests really enter into the way she writes, and she writes about questions of veganism in a way that bring in issues of popular culture, some of the literary studies that she's involved in. And her activist interests having to do with women and opposition to racism and so forth enter into her approach to her major topic in this book. She is a professor of English at Western Carolina University in North Carolina, and in addition to the books that she's written, she's authored any number, I can't even summarize them, any number of articles, reviews, book chapters, and a slate biographical detail. She's also a long distance runner. If you have read the book, you'll know that there's, I'm gonna start and get her to talk about the book now, and what we're going to do is talk for about 45 to 50 minutes and then open up the floor. But I want to get her to talk about some of the framing of the book at first, because it starts with some autobiographical prose, which you'll notice if you read it, but you get an impression early on in the book of what led her to write the book, and I'd like to start there. How did you come to write this fantastic book?
Thanks. There was actually an article that sort of led me to write this book, and it was by a guy named Harold Frome, who is an eco-critic, somebody who writes about the environment in literature. He's a really, really well-known one, also co-authored a book called The Eco-Criticism Reader, which is kind of the foundational text in the field. So he's somebody whose work I had always really kind of admired, and he wrote an article in the Chronicle of Higher Education called Vegans and the Quest for Purity, and it just basically slammed vegans. It was like, you know, you're pretentious, you're grandstanding, why don't you all die, basically. I mean, he didn't say that specifically, but he said, you know, the idea is not to figure out one less thing to eat, one less animal to kill, but if you want to stop, you know, having an impact on the planet, you should just not exist, because that's the only way to do that. And I was so, like, taken aback. I can't remember when it came out, but it was a while ago, early 2000s, I think. And I wrote him a letter. I wrote a letter to the Chronicle, which got published in there. But I was, is it not working? Okay, sorry, I'm not used to talking into a microphone. I was really curious about where that idea came from, that we're all, you know, too precious to exist and that we're, you know, trying to force our moral ideas on other people. And so that's kind of the impetus for the book, was to kind of try and investigate where that image came from. And I'm not a person who studies U.S. culture. I actually study South African culture. And so it was really weird departure for me to write a book about America and to really look at where veganism shows up in mainstream popular culture in the United States, where it shows up in the news, how it gets treated in a film. So it was really fun to do that. And I was gonna say, somebody made a comment, I can't remember where it was, on Reddit or somewhere after it came out, and said, "This is the most American thing I've ever seen in my life." And I was like, that's awesome, that's exactly what I want. I mean, I think they meant it as sort of an insult, but I was really, I really thought that was a great thing.
I'm gonna go drag you out a little more on that first question, because I think you start the book partly with an anecdote about 9/11. Right. Can you just sort of explain how that factored into your writing this book?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember exactly how I got to 9/11. I was in graduate school in Massachusetts when that happened in 2001, so it was really, and then I taught in New York on Staten Island a few years later, and so many of the firefighters and the police officers who were involved in 9/11 live on Staten Island, and so it was just sort of a constant thing. And I started kind of looking at what was happening with regard to the rhetoric about food after 9/11. Actually, let me back up for just a second. Anthony Bourdain, do you guys know Anthony Bourdain? So he hates vegans, like really hates us. And he had a book that came out in 2000, so right before September 11th, called Kitchen Confidential. And he refers to vegans as, well, he says that, okay, vegetarians are like the enemies of everything good in the world. And vegans are their Hezbollah-like splinter faction. So he's, you know, calling us terrorists. And I was like, you know, what is the deal with that? He really does not like us. So I started with that, and then I kind of started looking at what happened around food after September 11th. And I'd been doing some research for the book initially, kind of looking at the history of veganism, like throughout time, really long history, in the United States, not that long. And in the 80s and 90s, there was this really interesting thing that happened where people got kind of interested in ethnic food. And by ethnic food, I mean like Asian and Indian food, which was very plant-based. So there was this really, really kind of strong interest in eating food that was not so much meat-based. And also Babe came out, that film, have you guys seen, about the pig? Yeah, so there's this really, you know, kind of really interesting things, getting sort of a pro-vegetarian consciousness in mainstream culture. And after September 11th, everything kind of turned around from that. And one of the things that George Bush said after we were attacked was, you know, I ask you to uphold American values. And that included food too. So suddenly there was this like deep suspicion of anything that wasn't American. And you could get on watch lists for getting on a plane if you ordered a vegetarian or a vegan meal. The Republican National Convention sent underground sort of spies to vegan potlucks in 2008 to see what people were saying about the Republican. I mean, really. And I have a cartoon that's actually in the book that is by Tony Pizer, who is a political cartoonist. And he's got this guy up at a podium, and he's saying, Muslims eat hummus, Muslims are terrorists, vegans eat hummus, therefore vegans are terrorists, or something kind of like that. So, you know, we sort of shifted back toward having to define ourselves by all kinds of things that were American. And one of those was, you know, meat and potatoes and all of these other things. And the other, I have an illustration of this as well. I don't know if you guys remember Freedom Fries, but yeah, there was a restaurant in North Carolina, my state, that decided that after France didn't back us on a military action, that we would not use French in French fries anymore. We would start calling them freedom fries. And so that actually went into place, and people were calling French fries freedom fries for a while. So that's kind of the September 11th thing. And also, I think at about that time was when I became a vegan. I had been vegetarian since the 80s and was in graduate school working on Katsia, who writes about animals and writes about all kinds of things that really got me more interested in kind of choosing this lifestyle. So all of that kind of came together, and yeah. And I also started a blog, and so that's where a lot of the kind of personal stuff that's in here comes from, because I was like, I'm going to do this blog, and I'm going to call it The Vegan Body Project, and it's still out there if anybody's interested. No one reads it. It's really, you know, really not on anybody's radar. But it was the way that I was kind of trying to talk about some of the issues that were going on. And also because I wanted this book to be less academic in some ways than other stuff I'd written. I was really hoping that it would be kind of a more mainstream crossover sort of book. I don't know if I succeeded with that or not, but that was my goal with it.
I was really struck by some of the statistics that you give early in the book. I'm going to mention two things. Well, one's a prediction and the other is a statistic. You cite a statistic early in the book that says in 2006 there were 1.7 million vegans in the U.S. And I think that struck me because I think a lot of people who are vegans feel really isolated. Mm-hmm. And so I wondered sort of where the numbers are now. And then you cite a prediction by Kathy Stevens that the U.S. will go vegan by 2050. And I thought, short of some epidemic that makes people allergic to animal products, which mm-hmm. is actually possible,
yeah.
I'm not sure I could imagine it. So my question for you is, because I think it is one of the things you're doing in the book is bringing out how, at least as far as our politics and our popular culture are, we're in a vegan cultural moment. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean?
Yeah, and I'm not sure where the statistics are on veganism in the United States right now. I'd have to go back and look at that. And in terms of the 2050 statistic, that really struck me as impossible as well. I know, I mean, I tend to be like this really pessimistic person, which is not good, but I have met recently, I think it's because of my generation, I hear that Gen X is like that, and that millennials, I know everybody hates that term, but actually people are much more optimistic, and I've really become friends with like younger vegans who have all this optimism, which I love, and who they really believe this stuff, and I hope it's true. But yeah, I don't know. I think there's so much pushback against that idea of us, you know, adopting a vegan diet. I was in the UK in May, and I feel like there's much more acceptance over there right now than there is over here. And that struck me as really odd because the last time I was there, which was, I don't know, 8 or some years before that, I didn't feel like there was anything going on. So I don't know. I'd be curious to know, I guess, what other people think about. And so you don't think that either, or I don't know.
I don't have a scientific relationship to the issue.
Wonder. I don't know how. Yeah. I think that, you know, for the planet, maybe it would be. Maybe we're going to come to a crisis point where it becomes necessary because I'm not sure how we sustain what we're doing environmentally and long term. But that, you know, that...
We know that argument. Yeah, I know. Yeah.
And that implies some sort of massive collapse, which... Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm hoping to have you give people an impression of some of the really, really interesting things you do with popular culture. Oh. And so one of the chapters in her book is devoted to vampire and zombie narratives and the way in which vegan themes are woven into them. And I wasn't going to choose one in particular for you to talk about, but can we hear about vampires and zombies? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the vampire chapter was actually the first chapter that I wrote, mm-hmm. and I did it for fun. Like I was watching True Blood, that show on HBO. Have you guys seen True Blood? Okay, so, I mean, if you haven't seen it, you should probably go back and watch all of it. It's terribly campy and really bad. It's like it was really good the first season, and then it just all falls apart. But I was really interested in it because the vampires drink this stuff called True Blood, which is synthetic blood. And I had found a comic online somewhere, which I could never locate again after the first time I found it, of Bill Compton, who's the main vampire character, wearing a shirt that says Southern Vegan on it. And I just thought, that's so cool. Like, these are vampires who are vegan, and then they're actually vegan to pass. Like, they're not, I mean, vampires are doing what they've always done, which is drink the blood of human beings. But in order to be accepted into human society, they've become vegan, which is like a total oxymoron, because in reality, you're a vegan and you're totally not accepted in modern society. So they're using it kind of as a screen. They're pretending to be vegan, but they're also drinking people on the side, if that makes sense. So I was interested in that. And I started thinking, vampires are fascinating because they change over time. And I kind of started with Dracula and took it all the way to True Blood. I also looked at the Twilight books and the Twilight films, where the vampires are vegetarians because they eat animals, which is exactly not what a vegetarian is. And I also looked at Buffy the Vampire Slayer because I love that series so very much. And I really, that one was a stretch for me to try and find anything in there, but I just wanted to put it in there so bad. But I think, you know, that at every stage in vampire history, and there's been a really long history of vampires in popular culture, they always kind of mirror the things about us that were most repressing. And so I was really curious what it means to repress all the bad stuff if you're in True Blood. Like, they're actually repressing their, like, their basest desires, and they appear kind of like this weird undead moral majority in some way. And I was wondering what that means about us, that perhaps we are already so brutal that we don't need a vampire to show us brutality anymore. So that was kind of where I went with that one. And with the zombies, I was just sort of fascinated in, I looked at a novel called The Road by Cormac McCarthy, and a novel, I looked at Margaret Atwood's Oryx and Crake, even though there aren't literal zombies in that, but these people get a virus and they all die, and they start, you know, doing things that are really problematic. Just sort of interested in you know, what the solution is. If a zombie apocalypse comes, what do we eat at the end of the world? Because so much of our food is this mass-produced stuff that, you know, we won't have anymore if we've lost so much contact with the things that we grow and can cultivate. And there's a lot of imagery of that in zombie films in particular. I was thinking of 28 Days Later. I don't know if any, have you guys seen 28 Days Later? Also great. If you haven't seen it, you should totally see it. But there's a scene in a supermarket where they go in and all the food is like rotten, except for this display of apples that have been irradiated and they are still beautiful and green. And so they, you know, take the apples. But yeah, like, what happens if we all just, if society collapses? And so, yeah. That, I guess that, yeah. Those were fun, too. Those chapters are really fun, I thought.
Okay, I'm sure I have questions, but okay. I want to get a feel for more of the book before we open mm-hmm. the floor. So there's also a discussion of celebrity vegans in the book, mm-hmm. and at least one impression one gets from reading that material is that, to some extent, we have distortions in our in our impressions of what veganism is or can be from some of its celebrity spokespeople. And I wonder, is that, what impression are you hoping to create about the impact of the celebrity spokespeople for veganism?
Yeah, I mean, I think because vegans really want spokespeople, because mm-hmm. we do, you know, one thing I think is interesting about vegans, and I don't know how many of you guys are, people become vegan for lots of different reasons, for health reasons, for ethical reasons, for religious reasons, lots of different kinds of choices. But there's not like a movement of, I feel like vegans are, they're more kind of anarchist than they are coming together to create some kind of movement. And so when there is like a celebrity who suddenly becomes vegan, it's just like great thing to talk about, because you're like, oh, look, this person is vegan. And I think the example that I kind of come back to over and over again is Natalie Portman, who became vegan after she read Jonathan Safran Foer's Eating Animals. And she wrote this editorial for the New York Times and said, I have become an ethical vegan. I've been a longtime vegetarian, but I will never, you know, not be a vegan. And then she got pregnant and stopped being vegan. And it was like the vegan community just went nuts about this. And I think, you know, there's always that kind of tension about if you're a celebrity, we want you to be a spokesperson for us, but it's not really fair to do that in some ways, because the scrutiny that we're kind of applying to these people, you know, puts them in a different kind of place. And I was thinking too about Ellen DeGeneres, who's vegan, but also is a spokesmodel for CoverGirl, which tests on animals, and there was a lot of kind of controversy about that. So I don't know. I think being a celebrity and having that identity does get a lot of scrutiny. And another thing, there's always that kind of continuum of, are you vegan enough? Are you too vegan? I think Woody Harrelson is, you know, Anthony Bourdain thinks he's too vegan because he's a raw foodist and doesn't eat anything that isn't, you know, that is above a certain temperature. But that, you know, there's this line always trying to determine what vegan is. And celebrities, I think, are just, they're in a limelight in a way that the rest of us don't have to be. So yeah, it's interesting to watch what happens if you are a vegan and looking at vegans talking about celebrities who are vegan and trying to figure out which ones are and which ones aren't. There's a lot of stuff in the press about Kristen Stewart being vegan after Twilight because she plays a vegetarian character in Twilight in the film. The director of the film is vegetarian. And so there's all this media about Kristen Stewart being vegetarian and she's not. So that happens a lot too, and PETA will get out there and, like, you know, prop up celebrities and say this person's vegan and then they aren't and then everyone gets mad. So I don't know if that really answers the question, but yeah, it's complicated.
I'm sure everyone will have questions for you. This isn't the next thing I had planned to ask you, but since you brought up Natalie Portman mm-hmm. and the issue of pregnancy, mm-hmm. I can mention again that another theme in the book, at least several passages, is the amount of misinformation we have in our culture about health and veganism, mm-hmm. and that often, I guess it's this, I'm running together two things that do get beautifully brought together in your book, which is issues of gender. They're very important. And one of the places we see misinformation about veganism is in connection with things like pregnancy and breastfeeding. So you mentioned at one point that women are often told they can't breastfeed if they're vegan or they can't have a healthy pregnancy. Is one of your aims in this book to get out better information about health and veganism?
Yeah, I felt like there were a couple of places in particular where the news has really gotten this wrong. And one, I had a chapter where I talk about death by veganism, which is occasionally a child will die and the media will blame the fact that the parents were vegan for the child's death. Whenever this happens, it's like this big thing that shows up in the media, and it's always associated with being vegan. And I kind of went back and looked at some of these cases to sort of see what was going on there. And it's not because the parents are vegan, it's because they're terrible parents. You know, like these are cases of abuse and neglect. They're not cases of veganism. And so, but I think, you know, if the parents are vegan, then that's going to get glommed onto. Also, a mother, you know, there was a story in the news about a mother breastfeeding and her child died because she was vegan and her breast milk did not contain enough B12 for the child. And, you know, the B12 thing is interesting. It's always this sort of debate about how much you need to have and if you're going to deplete all of it. And, you know, if you're not getting it from animal protein, can you actually get it? So that was another one. The other thing, and this isn't what you asked me, but I wanted to really address this one, which is about anorexia. I have a colleague named Hal Herzog who is an anthropologist. Oh no, I'm sorry, he's a psychologist. And he has written a book called Some We Love, Some We Hate, Some We Eat. And he and I, we're really good friends, but we don't agree about a whole lot. And he had written a fair amount about the fact that there's a link between veganism and eating disorders. And this really bugged me too. And so I went back and really looked at, there's all this stuff out there about, you know, actually psychological studies of people saying, you know, that this is a strategy of food avoidance in young women, and they're not eating these things because they actually have anorexia. And what I found was that kind of the same thing with the, you know, the parents are bad parents. the people who are anorexic are anorexic. They're simply not eating. And veganism doesn't have anything really to do with that. But it gets, you know, treated this way in the media. And so he and I have kind of gone around and around arguing about that. But I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that when people have anorexia, and I'm a person who had anorexia, and veganism, I mentioned this yesterday in another talk I was giving, veganism was the thing that actually got me over it. So I think that that was another kind of place that I wanted to come at. And I have narratives from people in the book who had really similar experiences with eating disorders and becoming vegan and the ways in which veganism is actually was actually the thing that made them better, I guess. Yeah.
You partly answered a question I had, but I think I want to, just because of the importance of what you do in the book with the gender stereotyping of veganism, mm-hmm. the idea that this is, it can be connected with eating disorders in women, or a sort of marginalization of the idea that men can be Hegans, I guess is the term. And one of the themes, at least I take it, of your discussion of these issues is that this gender stereotyping is in part an attempt to undercut some of the social and political movements mm-hmm. which get expressed in championing of veganism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think going back to sort of the thing about pregnancy, I think what women eat gets policed all the time. I mean, people constantly are commenting on what women eat and what women should eat, and if you're pregnant, what you should be eating, and all of this stuff. And I think, you know, if you are vegan for a lot of the reasons that people are, ethical vegan, health reasons, religious reasons, that does really undercut a decision that was made from a moral stance. You know, to say that what you're doing is actually restricting your diet. And I actually feel like I eat a lot more now than I did when I wasn't. Of course, it's been a really long time since I was eating meat. But, you know, if you move away from the standard American diet, which is very heavy in fat and carbohydrates, and towards a more plant-based diet, then you actually open up your palate a lot more. I mean, it's challenging, and I don't cook. I'm a really bad, like I subsisted on bagels and apples for a really long time because I don't cook, and I married someone who does, which is awesome for me. But I think that, you know, I think it works in a different way with men. It's okay for women to be vegan. I mean, we'll forgive them for that. In fact, the stereotype is that we are mostly women anyway, that we're just, you know, kind of ethereal and too precious for life. But if men do it, then there is this whole other component of, you know, these sort of accusations that that's not manly because meat is so associated with masculinity. And I wrote, there is Hegan. I was going to mention that this is a term that gets applied to guys who have eaten all the horrible stuff and had really bad health effects from it, like Bill Clinton, for example. I love Bill Clinton, but when he was in office, he was trying to eat himself to death. I don't know if you guys remember. I mean, he was just cheeseburgering it out, and he ended up having a heart condition and became vegan, or largely vegan, as a result of all of that. So he's a Hegan, which is, you know, not the same thing as like just a normal guy being a vegan. He's like lived the tough life and eaten the manly foods, has had a health crisis, and is now vegan, and that's somehow more acceptable. Than if you're, no, seriously, this is, so it's so gendered. And I mean, you can see this in advertising. There was a great Burger King ad that I talk about called the Mantham commercial, which is about all these men declaring their kind of men's rights to eat burgers and not have to eat chick food. It's great. It is a really hilarious ad. It came out, I think, in the early 2000s or maybe even the late 90s.
This is the kind of thing Fabio does, too. Yes.
Does he do that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
but I think a lot of people here know that, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that about Fabio. That's fascinating. I'll have to go look at that.
Yeah.
So, no, that's...
I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. Yeah. But there's a lot of advertising, particularly for fast food, that really plays up that idea that, you know, men should be eating meat, and that if you're not, you're failing as a man. And I think that's really unfortunate for men in so many ways.
I'm going to ask you a question that I can't really ask in full voice because I know so well what I think my answer to it is. But since we're in food studies talking about this book, I feel like we should have the question on the table and hear what you have to say when someone asks you the following question, which is, can you be a vegan if you love food? Because we get asked this all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, can you eat chocolate? It's like one of the first things that people ask. Yes, I think you can. I think that because our society is so set up to feed us things that are convenient and easy and contain meat, and we are so sold on the idea that we need these things, it becomes more challenging to love food and be a vegan, because it means you have to actually figure out how to eat things that are not the easiest go-to things necessarily. Although I'm a big fan of vegan junk food. For lunch today, I went to there's a place called Red Bamboo. I don't know if anybody, I love that place. Okay, so it's like total fake meat. Everything there is, which is another thing. You know, people are like, well, why do you eat things that taste like meat if you're a vegan? I actually think I liked the way meat tasted. It's not that I gave it up because I disliked the taste. I gave it up because I disliked the way it got to my plate. So I love eating things like, you know, kind of veggie burgers with daiya on them and French fries and all this stuff. And luckily, you can get that stuff now. And you guys live in a place where you can get it all over the place, which is great. That question, and I'm being terrible as a food studies person. I should be telling you to go out and eat lots of whole grains and everything like that. But yes, I think, you know, that you, particularly in a place like New York, you have such great resources to get anything. And I have never, the only thing I missed was cheese. And I have read that cheese actually affects your body the same way that cocaine does, that it actually, you become addicted to it. And so I felt that when I gave up cheese for about 6 months. No, it wasn't that long. It was a couple of months, but I was kind of depressed about it. And then I got over it, and I feel like I eat, like I said, so much more, and so much more good stuff than I ever did before I became vegan. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can I ask what you're thinking about it is, since you said you had an answer?
I just meant like yes, that's my answer. Yes. I live in a vegan mm-hmm. household, and I'm not into like food denial. It's yeah. I like to go out drinking. I wasn't gonna, anyway, I'm not answering
no
questions.
That's okay, but I'm curious to know.
At least not unless someone really presses me. But now I'm going to ask a question in full voice, because I am a moral philosopher, and when I write about these things, I often come at them really strictly from the point of view of moral and political considerations in favor of veganism. And I like to say things like, the moral and political argument is a really easy one, because you can choose any argument you want. You mm-hmm. can choose the animal ethics argument, you can choose the environmental case, and think about, you know, groundwater contamination and the use of fossil fuels in, you know, getting animals into CAFOs and then to industrial slaughterhouses and then distributing. Nothing's local. You can talk about public health considerations. You have mass prophylactic antibiotic use mm-hmm. in industrial farming and also in industrial sea farming. And you have human rights abuses in the animal industrial system. So although I do write about animals and ethics, I like to say it's a knockdown argument. You can mm-hmm. choose anyone you want, it's a good argument. And mm-hmm. Each of these lines of thought shows up at some place in the book. But I wondered about your motives, and this is really coming from me, about writing a book which showcases a cultural moment that shows its moral and political awareness, but that's not the only drive in this book. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is a great question. I think there are a few things to say about that. The first one is that when I wrote the book, I was afraid that if I got, I did not want it to ruin my life. I didn't, you know, because I live in the world, and I said I'm fairly pessimistic. I'm also fairly, I was talking about this with a friend earlier today, sort of walk around sad a lot, because I think if you are vegan for any of the reasons, particularly the animal ones that you actually don't want the things that are happening to animals to happen to them, then it's really hard not to know that that's happening. It's really hard to go in a grocery store. It's really hard to, you know, to do a lot of things. So when I was writing the book, I was on sabbatical, and I sort of lost my mind for like the semester that I was off. It was in the winter. I was writing all this stuff about, you know, these kind of horrible things, but I also wanted to keep it in a place where those things were there, but they weren't the driving thing behind the book. Like I try really hard not to preach to people, and I feel like that's, you know, one of the things that vegans get accused of all the time. So the argument, I think, like you said, I'm glad that you feel this way, that all of that is in there, but the book more is about why we perceive this choice the way we do. And I was hoping that, you know, in shedding light on that, then that actually would propel people to think differently about the image that we have of people who make this decision, and that maybe that would be a powerful way to kind of reconsider the stereotypes that exist. And also maybe that's how you change thinking. At least I hope so. So
that's a really great answer. And I'm not going to say more than this. I have a couple more questions for you, and then I want to open up to everybody who's here. But what you said about not wanting to walk around your environment and feel just sort of disoriented and confused is something I've heard a lot of people who are animal activists say, and one of the reasons I think a lot turn to the writings of J.M. Coetzee the way you have, because of the power of the portrayal of Elizabeth Costello as someone who is the embodiment, at least in the lives of, and the portion of Elizabeth Costello that's in the lives of animals, that she's portrayed as unable to sort of handle what's going on around her. But I really wanted just to give you a chance to tell us what you wanted people to take away from this book, if there's anything we haven't covered yet that you'd like to talk about.
Yeah, I think that maybe just an understanding of this moment that you say that we're in, which I think we are as well. I've been sort of a part of this moment for a while now, for close to a decade, I guess, at this point. And before that, in, you know, the 80s and 90s, also as a vegetarian, and trying to like map a bit of a history of how that has happened. So yeah, I think showing the history behind it, how we got to this moment culturally, to recognize it as a moment within our culture, and not to walk away from it, not to just let it go, and not to malign it, but to sort of really explore why it matters. And also maybe to have people believe that it matters after looking at the things that I'm talking about. And like I said, I tried to make it much more accessible than any of the other stuff I've ever read. I really wanted it to reach more people. I'm gonna get a little emotional about this, but when the book came out, I have written other things, and if you're a scholar and you write, maybe this isn't true for you, but the things that I've written, they don't really sell a whole lot. You know, people are not out there. I'm not, you know, a bestseller of anything. And when this book came out, I was like, I am going to make people see it, at least to the best of my ability. And so I've done everything I know to do to, like, and like this, for example, to just be out there and to talk about it. In the hope that maybe it does actually reach a few people, and it seems to be doing that. I'm having people contact me and tell me that they liked it and that they appreciate what it does, so that feels really fulfilling. Yeah.
Okay. I could go on with questions, but I really think the point of this evening is to give you a chance to ask questions, anyone who's here. So I'm happy to moderate. Floor is open.
I was taking mad notes while you were talking because I've been a vegan for about 25 years, and I don't want to turn this into an autobiographical moment, but a couple of things I wrote down were this idea that veganism is not really a movement, and then if you're vegan, you're totally not accepted in modern society. I came to veganism through punk rock and through the animal rights movement in the Pacific Northwest, which I still think fondly of as the vegan capital of the world, yeah. really. And and also, you were talking about acceptance in the UK, which isn't really what I experienced when I lived over there, I guess because I was coming from a different part of this country. So I wanted to ask you, maybe this is a little too esoteric, but about this idea of geography and veganism. You know, you talk a lot about pop culture, but I think one of the things that needs to be addressed is that veganism has come into the mainstream, certainly in New York. You know, Red Bamboo is one of, I don't know, 40 or 50 vegan restaurants.
Yes.
So do you think that it is fair to say that veganism no longer exists in these little difficult pockets of difficult, you know, activist people, that it's come into the mainstream? And do you think that that's true in just the United States or in other countries, or am I being too much of an optimist for my generation? Or?
No, I love that. No, and I feel bad. I just trashed our entire generation. But I think that's a great question. And I do think that it is in the mainstream. And that's part of why, I guess I don't mean that, you know, there aren't people who are sort of coalesced around it in certain places. And yeah, I mean, in New York, in the Pacific Northwest, absolutely, in Asheville where we live, it's, you know, totally, everything's totally good with this. But I guess in entering the mainstream, there's been what I thought was a really big backlash against it, which is kind of what, you know, in terms of representation. And I think that's controlled by a lot of different factors, one of which is the animal, people who are, you know, wanting us to eat animals and animal products. And so as we become sort of more visible and there is perhaps more acceptance, there's also this sort of pushback against it, which I think happens to any kind of identity. I do think I teach at a really rural institution in Western North Carolina. I live in Asheville. In large part because I don't know that I could actually live happily in Cullowhee, where my university is. It's incredibly rural. There's like one grocery store in the whole town. And I think for my students, it's a completely different world. Like they don't, I think for them it is the most foreign thing that they could possibly imagine for most of them. And I think even yesterday when I was at Wagner speaking on Staten Island, I think for a lot of them it is too. So I think it is still, you know, sort of regionally specific. I do think, you know, there is an issue that needs to be addressed in terms of access to vegan food. And it's something that Breeze Harper, who's an African-American vegan who writes about this issue in terms of race, says, you know, that there are, for most middle-class white Americans, access to a vegan diet is not that hard. For people of color who are not living in suburbs and not living, you know, in sort of these centers where there is food, that live in sort of food deserts, it's a very different thing. So yeah, I think region, I think race, I think gender, and in terms of other cultures, I don't know. Like I said, it's so weird that I actually am just sort of looking at the United States because I've never done that before. I've been to South Africa, and we did all right over there in Cape Town. But again, that's a very, you know, urban kind of center where we were able to find lots of food. And in the UK, when I was there, I may have a really biased kind of view because I was actually at a conference that was on vegan theory. So sort of, you know, I was engulfed in my people. And so, you know, I felt really, like we were doing a lot of work, and a lot of them were from the UK, and they were talking about the traction that veganism has gotten just over the past decade. And to me, it did seem different. I felt like in every restaurant we went into, it was very clear what was vegan. There were always vegan options. But again, that was in London and Oxford. So I don't know about, you know, once you get outside of, one of the guys who was there is from Scotland, and he said, he would kill his grandmother for Earth Balance and Daya if they just had that in the UK. I know, really very nice. Maybe he said he would sell her. I can't remember. But it was something. But, you know, I think that there are things that we can have that, like, make for really good vegan grilled cheese sandwiches that they can't have over there. So, yeah, I hope that answers the question. Yeah, cool. Sure.
Can you talk about the environmental movement and why there is very little, if any, discussion even from leading environmental groups that are doing great work on climate change but barely mention this issue at all in any of their campaigns or websites or anything. And then second question, what do you think works in terms of getting people to switch to a vegan or more plant-based diet? We've seen sort of infighting on whether or not campaigns like Meatless Mondays is good, or whether that's just being good one day of seven and you're killing animals the other six. You know, there's this infighting, and I'm interested in like what works. So
that is, I maybe we will know what works someday. I think in terms of the environmental movement, I mean, the big conference that just happened in Paris where we reached all this climate change stuff was not a vegan event. And just, you know, there's been stuff written about that, you know, that the next one better be, because this is one of the biggest environmental crises of our time. And to address it, I mean, the thing we should all do is be vegan. And I realize, but I think again, so much is controlled by who has the money. And, you know, if this is the corporations who are putting meat and dairy into everything that we eat, have so much to do. And you said Cowspiracy, which I haven't seen. But
Cowspiracy
is, yeah. And is it? See, I have a really tough time watching this stuff because it just upsets me so much. And I feel like it's preaching to the choir, but I should probably watch it just because I would have a better answer for this question. And in terms of what works, I've always felt like, we were kind of talking about this before everybody kind of came in, I have known people, and more of them recently than in the past, who actually will not eat with people who are not vegan, because they're like, this is my moral stance, and I need people to know that it's not okay that they're doing this. And I can't do that. I can't imagine that that's actually a productive way of changing anyone's mind. I'm thinking all that's gonna do is get you further stereotyped and alienated by everybody else in your life. And so, the way I've always approached this, and Carol Adams, who wrote the introduction for my book, who's a really dear friend and a foundational scholar in terms of looking at vegetarianism in literature and popular culture, she and I disagree about this completely, because she's very much kind of like an in-your-face, here are the issues, at every chance she can get, which is great for her. But I've always sort of been like, I'm gonna live my life quietly over here, and anybody that I interact with, I hope can see the life that I'm living, and perhaps think that that is a good life. And you know, my hope is always to just sort of be an example. I don't know if it's worked. I have known quite a few of my students and friends who have become at least vegetarian over the course of their relationship with me. And so, yeah, maybe it's about tolerance of other people, and also just trying to live a life that demonstrates what it means. Yeah, my thinking at least.
Okay, I guess I'm the smallest one here, yeah. But also the older one. I'm a dietitian by trade. Graduated at 40. I'm from Peru. I came in the 70s, but it's a long story. And I became just vegetarian till 2008, when I saw in Chinatown when somebody says, "Oh, fish," you know, fish, and when I saw the fish dying, I remember my asthma attacks for some reason, and I start crying like a little child, and I never eat a fish ever since then.
Absolutely.
Okay, so don't you think there is also like an spiritual, now that that I see that there is this spiritual world, and also the economy, where it's kind of like versus, spiritual versus the economic times that we are living. Because of that, I was able to leave. I went to live in Cuba, Mexico, my own country, Peru. And I noticed that in Peru, there is a big movement that nobody talks about. Interesting. Which is very, I was like shocked because Peru is very much into like meats, you know, and especially now with the booming gastronomy. However, I found for a lot of reasons to preserve our land, to preserve our farmers, the way that we farm and everything like that. So it's growing, but nobody talks about. So there's something about culture and also economics. Mm-hmm. For example, Latinos, when we come to United States, if we say we'll be, oh, she's poor. I went to Indonesia, and I was in Thailand and Indonesia just past November. And instead of buying the junk food, I love these people who bring like baked like potatoes or something like that. And I was eating that. And I had a friend with me, and we were both criticized because we were the poor tourist coming from the United States. So there's something cultural, economics, and something spiritual, and those issues never get discussed into why we should be at least vegetarians, like you said.
No. I think that's a, the spiritual aspect, I think, is something that I didn't consider really at all. I mean, I know people do make that ethical choice for religious reasons, but I think that, you know, when you said that you saw the fish and that was the moment when you were like, I can't do this anymore, something about actually seeing the animal, and that's another thing. I think we are so disconnected from where our food comes from, so we don't see what happens to it. And I was running in Central Park today, and somebody had chalked on the ground. It said, if slaughterhouses were made of glass, no one would eat meat, go vegan. I took a picture of it because I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. But my experience was going to a sausage processing plant when I was 13 years old on a class trip. And yeah, that did it for me, and I never ate sausage again. And when I turned 18, stopped eating meat altogether because of that experience. And I think it has something to do, and spiritual is a good word for it, but with that kind of spiritual connection that you make when you are looking at you're receiving the gaze of the animal, and you know it is looking back at you, that I think is really powerful. So yeah. And I know there was more to your question about economics, but yeah, those three things together, and we don't talk about them in kind of intertwined ways, which seems really important to kind of consider all of these issues, which is, I think, one of the approaches that I consider in the book is the way that all of these oppressions are in some way linked. And, you know, if we talk about them as linked, and I think it's, you know, intersectional at this point is the term, but to consider the intersections between these things, otherwise we're not gonna get out of any of it.
First, thanks for coming. I really appreciate it.
Thanks.
I have to go to the mic.
Apparently.
It helps pick it up, I think.
That's part of the
problem. Oh, no.
First, thanks for coming. I really appreciate it. I was a little surprised to see you say that you love Bill Clinton when he has one of the darkest histories out of any president regarding animal factory farming. Mm-hmm. And so to remind people, Clinton, Bill and Hillary's rise to power is Walmart and Tyson Foods, both from Arkansas. Mm-hmm. And so actually in the Clinton administration, I don't know if you're aware of the scandals with the USDA secretary, mm-hmm. in the Clinton administration, are you aware?
I think.
So the chief of staff to Mike Epsi, I believe was his name.
Yeah.
The chief of staff went to prison, and two Tyson Food lobbyists went to prison for illegal lobbying by Tyson Foods. And just so everyone knows, Tyson Foods is a $41 billion, mm-hmm. I just actually checked while I was waiting.
Yes, huge.
$41 billion in sales, mm-hmm. animal factory farm, mm-hmm. Death company. And what was the most scandalous part about all of this is that in the final days of the Clinton administration, Bill pardoned all three of them.
Yeah.
Okay, so there were actually Tyson Foods lobbyists in prison, and Bill, because of his longstanding history with Tyson Foods, actually allowed them all to be liberated.
Okay, so I don't really love him. I mean,
okay, I just wanted to hear that. Thank you.
I mean, yeah. God, this is the thing about.
I just like catching people when they say that because no, it's important for you as a really intelligent person and a respected person for us to be clear. I'm not a saint by any means, but I've not pardoned Tyson Foods lobbyists.
No, and that I get that completely. And this kind of goes back to that sort of celebrity issue in terms of veganism. I mean, he's gotten a lot of attention for this decision to be vegan, and he's kind of become a bit of a celebrity as a result. I don't love him. I also think, he's done lots of problematic things with regard to women. There are plenty of things.
I actually think
that there's a linkage between all of that. Like I said, I think, oppressions are, in fact, inherently linked, and that they are, to me, those things are all issues with regard to him. So, yeah, I don't really, one of the things that I actually have a slideshow on that I'm not showing you guys right now because I just don't want to talk about it anymore is kind of our interest in what the political candidates right now are doing with regard to animals. And the sort of desire that everyone had for Bernie Sanders to be vegan, and then he isn't, and Trump has these, Trump has steaks, and this isn't really kind of going to your, I don't know that it was a question so much as a correction.
Well, I'm just creating dialogue.
Yeah, no.
But interestingly enough, I spoke with Chelsea Clinton once for like 10 minutes. This was maybe 6-7 years ago. I was like, your dad, like what an example of changing his health and becoming a vegan and changing, like you should encourage him to speak out more. And it's interesting over the past 5 years how he barely, he eats mostly an organic diet.
Right.
Right? How he never talks about that.
No, of course not. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it's just that complete control and corruption by industrial agriculture, Monsanto, Cargill, et cetera, and control over all of them.
Right, and I think that, that goes back to that question of silencing, again, of the things that we're not talking about and all of the really complicated reasons for why that's the case. So I appreciate your bringing that up.
My second question, you were talking about terrorism, really interesting, and just your take on the modern eco-terrorism, a lot of environmentalists, food activists, vegan activists are in, terror watch lists. And just the latest on that, in your opinion, because you've been talking about that subject.
Yeah. I think that, again, sort of equating what I think you're talking about with terrorism is in a lot of ways really problematic, right? Like, can you give me an example of an action that you're thinking of when you say that, or just sort of generally speaking?
Like one of my friends who's a vegan activist twice had the FBI in the middle of the night come to his home and, interview him for a couple hours.
Right.
Just
show up because he's, and because again.
Just because he's affiliated with certain people, but just a general data collection on people who are, the eco-terrorists. And there are some eco-terrorists that do
bad things,
like kill people,
right.
But just the proliferation of that, and it's actually not really discussed in the environmental movement, and it's way bigger than people realize.
Right.
And I think it's important.
No,
because a lot of us are in it.
Yeah, and no, I think that kind of even goes back. I'm not entirely sure when this sort of when this became such a big deal. I'd be interested in knowing if it was linked again to kind of that September 11th moment when. Yeah, when
green is the new red. It's got to be like his go-to place for Will Potter's book.
Right.
Is, yeah. But it's been exploited.
Yeah. So that danger. I think it is a dangerous identity to have in a lot of ways. This is not at all related to that, but I just want to tell this story because Like I said, I live in rural North Carolina, and this is not being on anybody's watch list, but I pulled my car up to fill it up with gas not too long ago, and these two guys in a pickup truck, and I have a vegan sticker on the back of my car. These two guys pulled up beside me in a pickup truck and started, they scared the crap out of me. One of them said, "Do you eat steak?" And I'm like putting gas in my car, and I was like, "No." "Do you eat chicken?" And I said, "No." And I'm like trying to figure out what is happening at this moment. And all I can think is I'm being harassed because of the vegan bumper sticker. And the guy leaned over, the guy in the passenger seat, and he was like, "You should eat a fucking steak, sweetheart." And I was so scared. And that's, that is nothing more than simply having a vegan sticker on my car, not even doing anything activist, just being in the world and pronouncing that I'm vegan. So yeah, I'm not sure I'm answering your question, but.
All's good, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hey, slight departure
sure.
from that. So I am wondering about, I feel like in this moment that wellness culture is mm-hmm. having, like this prevailing, athleisure and like veganism and the co-optization of yoga, like it's all lumped into this big category, right? And a lot of scholars are writing about it and a lot of people are going back and forth. And so I'm wondering, actually both of you could probably speak to this, but I'm wondering if I read an article that was sort of like the problem with like wellness as a virtue, stuff like this. And I think we could all agree that veganism kind of fits in the category of wellness, of being well. It sort of implies a lot of those things. But I'm wondering if you guys ever feel in your scholarly circles even more kind of like made fun of or like ridiculed due to writing about this kind of stuff, or sort of like, because I hang out in a lot of scholarly and like artist circles, and I find that the wellness thing is often a real problem for especially like males because it's like, oh, like, we should all, but like, let's wreck our bodies because we're writers and we're gonna die, and like, let's smoke and like drink ourselves to death. Mm-hmm. Just totally fine, like, people can do that. But so I'm wondering if you ever encounter that and like how you sort of deal with that. It's like a question I've been thinking about a lot lately. Do you?
I can answer, but go ahead.
Well, when we were sitting here, we're meeting for the first time, but we have mutual friends. And I think we came, and so we run in similar circles, and we came into what we do in different ways. And I was saying, I just finished writing a big book on human beings and animals. And my colleagues, I've been teaching animals for 20 years, and my colleagues were always like, "Oh, your animals book," like that. And it's interesting to be here at the New School. It's certainly, I think of it as true of the NSSR, the graduate faculty, that we have a radical orientation. It's not a normal place to be. It's an exciting place to be. And it's interesting to have your anti-neoliberal, Marxist, radical, anti-racist colleagues think that somehow you don't fit in. And I really, it's actually been eye-opening because I do feel your last question that, my students get it, that Will Potter's work is important, that they're on the streets with activists who are connecting these issues. But I'm mocked all the time. I'm very used to it. I don't have a vegetarian colleague in my own department. Not even one. I don't know. I'm not saying anything about food studies. I'm the chair of the philosophy department. So it might be scandalous that none of the philosophers are vegetarians.
That is interesting. I kind of, when I got to Western,
I feel like I've just gotten teased like sort of forever by my colleagues who are, who, you know, I respect and love so very much. And when I was at Wagner, I actually was talking to one of them about the fact that he used to just give me so much crap for being vegan. Like we would go, they had like a faculty dining room there and we would all go eat lunch together. And it was like this sort of constant joke with everybody that I was vegan. And I just kind of tolerated it. When I got to Western Carolina, they were so weirded out that I was a post-colonialist. Like that to them was like the, you don't do British and American lit. What in the world are you, are, yeah. So they were, you know, I have a really good friend and I'm calling my friends out because these are people I really love who, you know, called me as a joke forever, you know, called my specialization a boutique specialization. You know, I'm like, you do Chaucer. That's one dude from like one tiny sliver of history in England. I'm doing the rest of the world. Like I'm the world lit person. So that, I got that. And I think, you know, when I wrote this book, I think finally people were like, oh, that's a thing. And my colleagues have been really supportive, I think, of me. And I do have vegetarian colleagues. Actually, I have vegan colleagues. And I feel really lucky because of that. So, yeah, and I think in terms of the wellness stuff, one thing that you weren't asking this, but there's also within, I'm going to say the vegan community, even though I argue that there is actually no vegan community, but there's kind of a backlash against the association of veganism with wellness because, yeah, so many people don't believe that that's as legitimate as doing it for, you know, the animal or the environmental kind of reason. So yeah, that it, there's a tension there also, I think. Yeah. Good. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Alexis. Hi. So I work at Catskill Animal Sanctuary, and Kathy Stevens is my boss. And just to follow up with what you said earlier, something that she always says is that once a population, 10% of a population has gained a really strong idea, it catches like wildfire. And I've been vegan for 6 years, so since 2010. And I mean, since then, it seems like grocery stores have gone leaps and bounds. Like I can eat cheese again, you know? It's plant-based, but I can eat cheese. I can eat all sorts of things. And it seems like it's progressing pretty fast. So why, and I think you sort of answered this earlier, but I was hoping you could speak a little more to it. Why don't you think that the world could be vegan by 2050? I know that we're 3% vegetarian now. Mm-hmm. That's not vegan, and vegan might be a stretch, but I think at least vegetarian could be possible.
Well, no, and I it's not that I don't think, like I said, I'm just pessimistic by nature, I think. And maybe because, I mean, I'm thinking since 1988 I've been vegetarian. Maybe I'm just like sort of, you know, bitter and wounded because I feel like for so long it was really not, I felt like in the 80s there was all this kind of stuff and then I feel like it kind of, there was a backlash against it. Maybe there can be. I really like that, you know, that if that is true, when 10% of the population adopts a belief, then it will catch on because we're not that far away. Like you said, well, I mean, 3% is, it's closer than it was 20 years ago, I think. So maybe it can. I don't want to say it can't. I think it would be great if it could. Or even vegetarian, you know, just in that direction.
What do you think is holding us back?
I think there's a lot of stuff. I think, yeah, that, I mean, the industrial complex that is funding any number of things that are allowing us to eat without thinking about what we're eating. I also think in terms of our culture, we're very comfortable. It's very difficult to want to change what we do and what we've been taught to do. I mean, I think about just in terms of like family structure, if your parents weren't vegetarian, I mean, my parents feel deeply rejected on some level because of what I'm doing. So I think, you know, just even at the level of the family, the level of relationships,
more education, I think, is really important, and more, you know, kind of exposing what's going on behind the scenes, like you were talking about with the Clintons and with Tyson Foods, and just sort of letting people know, I guess, being better informed, and hopefully there will be more information as we go along. So, yes, I'll keep my fingers crossed. I would love that.
Right, a quick one. Okay. Books, movies, podcasts that you would recommend that you find convincing. I know the China study seemed to convince a lot of people. My conservative aunt switched to veganism in her 70s based on the China study. Right. Forks Over Knives seems to be successful. What books, documentaries, podcasts do you find compelling or convincing?
Well, I mean, I think Carol Adams' book, for example, The Sexual Politics of Meat, was the one that did it for me. And she wrote this book in 1991, and when I read it, it just changed everything. So, and I tend to read a lot of fiction. I think Katsia's Lives of Animals was really important. I also think Disgrace by him. So I don't listen to many podcasts, but in terms of books, those are ones that are important. I think Eating Animals is important by Jonathan Safran Foer. I'm trying to think what else has been really important. I had a friend, a colleague, who wrote a book called Pig in Thin Air that came out with Lantern Books. I haven't read it yet because I'm afraid it's just going to destroy me. But my husband Jason has and said that it's amazing. It's a sort of investigation of the treatment of factory farmed animals in a very literary kind of way. So those are good ones. I would say also Defiant Daughters, which is another Lantern book. And I'm clearly coming at this from kind of a feminist perspective with Carol Adams' books and with Defiant Daughters, which is a collection of essays about women and the way that the sexual politics of meat changed their lives. So I'm a big fan of those. Yes. Yeah, that's true. I forgot about that. Yeah. And I think, you know, for me, a lot of maybe not having the best answer to this is my own kind of inability to see a whole lot of it. I mean, I know Earthlings clearly. I can't watch it. So I think there's a line that I'm usually drawing because I feel like I'm already there and I don't want to see any more of it. I don't want to hear any more of it. In order to just survive in the world. And Food Inc., yes, definitely. So, yeah. Cool.
Hi. Hey. My name is Maureen. I've just been really thinking about how to phrase it, because I'm like all over the place, really excited to be, as you said, with our people.
Yeah.
So a lot of my friends tell me, because you mentioned something about how vegans tend to be preachy, and I am definitely, that is definitely my nature. Especially if you see like my social media, it's very loud and out there. Mm-hmm. And my friends and even my family, they are always saying, you know, Maureen, what? There are so many problems in this world. You know, there are children starving, and especially like Black Lives Matter, like that whole, I guess, movement. There, you know, a lot of people were saying, you know, they can't go. Their mothers will never see them again. Their families will never see them again. And you're worried about a pig. Mm-hmm. Worried about a chicken. And a lot of my friends also, they, you know, they identify like feminists and femme and like all that, like really label themselves in like these different activist mm-hmm. roles. And a lot are, you know, I volunteer with Oxfam and like Greenpeace and all of that, and they're like, you know, save the earth. And other friends, they will stop on a highway to save a dog or a cat or a possum or whatever it is. And yet they just, it just doesn't connect, and I just can't fathom that. And some of my friends that are, you know, like academics and all that, they say that emotional intelligence, people who are more emotionally intelligent and maybe less academic, that I guess you have to be more emotional in order to that you must be more emotional if you feel so strongly tied to this, which I don't know about anyone else, but for me that's like, well, you're not smart, but you know, you have a strong emotional intelligence. Like, no, I'm both. Mm-hmm. So,
yes,
you know, and it's just, and so just tying it up, like, so I have developed this defense, and while I'm out there, I'm also, like, I'm, like, struggling inside, like, while I tend to be preachy when approached, so real quick example, for my mom's 60th birthday, I wanted to actually enjoy cake with her because, you know, I never have cake with them. And so I bought her a vegan cake, and she was telling everyone, like, oh, it's vegan, and they're like, vegan? And then when they tried it, it was disgusting. And it wasn't because it was vegan, it was because it was disgusting.
Right.
And so, you know.
Yes.
And the place we got it from has amazing cakes. I just don't know what happened there, but this one was it was really disgusting.
It's terrible.
And there are some non-vegan cakes that are disgusting too.
Yeah.
But because she was saying it's vegan, so from then on when we would have events and my mom would say, oh, it's vegan, I'd be like, no thanks. And they would stay away, steer clear. So that, among other things that I've mentioned, have made me defensive. So now either, like, if someone says something I find offensive or criticizing vegans or veganism, either I'm really extreme, either like I get defensive or I just clam up.
Mm-hmm.
And so one thing I'm working on, not just as a vegan, but as a person, is to be less apologetic, I would say, mm-hmm. and more accepting. And it seems that in your circles and in your line of work, you've had to, you've grappled with the same things.
Yeah.
So I really want to know how you deal with that. And I feel the same sadness that you do, but how do you find peace within yourself on, like, when it's okay to be vegan, when it's okay to speak out, and when to kind of keep it in line.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. I went on a tangent, but.
No, that's really good. So a couple of things. Going back to Carol Adams again, who is such a kind of a mentor for me, she has a term that she uses, and it's retrograde humanism. I love this term. And yeah, so that's when, you know, somebody calls you out for not feeding the children or not being involved in something else because you care about animals. And I mean, it sounds to me like you're in Greenpeace, you're like, I mean, you're doing other things. It's just that kind of knee jerk. And I have a story about this that I always tell. I was in the car with my parents once. This was a long time ago. We're driving down the highway, and there's like two stray dogs running down the side of the road. And I was like, Dad, can you call animal control? Or can we call the cops or something? Because I wanted them to get picked up. You know, I didn't want them to be out there on the side of the road. And my mother turns around and goes, what if those were kids? Like, really accusatory. And I was like, I'd be really concerned. Like, why would they be out running on the highway? That doesn't make any sense. But, you know, so it's that kind of thing. So whenever that happens, I think Carol says it is, you know, when someone accuses you of not doing enough when they themselves are probably not doing as much as you are. And so I think holding that in my head is kind of a way of dealing. I haven't had anybody really do that to me in a long time, thankfully. Maybe because I have gotten in people's faces, like, who are close to me enough about it that they're just not gonna do that anymore. And I, you know, I posted on Facebook one day. This is about as in your face as I've ever gotten. And I don't post, you know, horrible videos of things happening. I can't look at those on other people's pages, and I'm not gonna do that. But I did post a series of things about veganism, and I just wrote, "What would it take to make you be vegan?" You know, like, here's the climate issue, here's all this stuff. And I had some of my colleagues got really sort of irritated with me about it. They were like, you know, why are you doing that? Why are you being that confrontational? And I was like, do you think that's confrontational?
Like, that's nothing. So I don't know. I feel like, you know, in making this decision, you sort of are putting yourself in a position that sets you at odds with so many people. And trying to navigate that space is incredibly difficult, I think. And trying to explain yourself and trying to, you know, demonstrate that you are doing something that you feel is right. So I, you know, all I can say is good for you. And I think you should be outspoken. And I'm sorry that you got a bad vegan cake. That's just, that's, you know, that will probably haunt you forever. And hopefully you can get a better one next time, and then everyone will come around to your way of thinking. Thank you so much for all of these questions, by the way.
Hi. I just want to know your opinion about something. Why a lot of people are vegan and vegetarian, and then something happens, and they start to eat meat and dairy again? Why? Because I think it's 8%. It's a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is, I had, again, my colleague Hal Herzog, who's the psychologist, who's, you know, basically trying to prove that no one's actually a vegan ever. We're all just kind of lying about it, because, there there is, you know, evidence to suggest that people will say they are and then they eat meat. And, you know, where is that line anyway? If you've accidentally eaten a piece of cheese once because it ended up in something that someone gave you, does that make you not a vegan enough or whatever? But I think, you know, I've heard that argument a lot from people. Well, I was vegetarian and then I got sick. And, you know, so now I'm, okay, you know, so you immediately assumed that it was because you weren't eating a cow. I hear that, and I do think in terms of, I don't want to say this because it's going to sound horribly pretentious, but in terms of the reasons why some people make this decision, it's an irreversible decision. Like for me, there's not, you know, if I get sick, I'm not going to eat meat. And I've gotten very sick since I've become vegan, and I've decided that it was not because I'm not eating a cow. But I think for a lot of people, maybe the reason is not an irreversible reason. You know, that they've done this for a reason other than my reason, or maybe a reason other than the reasons of people who are not going to go back from it. So maybe that's it. But I don't have a good answer for that either. But yeah, it's something that, you know, that thing with Natalie Portman, who, you know, was never gonna not be a vegan and then suddenly wasn't. And I was like, God, why did you do that to us? It was terrible. So yeah.
But I mean, it can be, like, in that case, and in a lot of cases, I think it can be connected to the misinformation issues. You think of the social pressures on women who are bearing children,
right,
and how much social pressure there is to be absolutely perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're being bombarded with information about how what you're doing is unhealthy for a not yet born child, it can be overwhelming.
Yeah.
Who knows what kind of, I mean, I do think veganism in community is easier.
Mm-hmm.
You need people to help you.
Yeah, it can be so, that's a good point. It can be so isolating if you don't have other people who you can talk to about it. And I think, you know, for a lot of people it's overwhelming. It's really lonely in a lot of ways if you don't have a community to help you out with it. So maybe that's part of it too.
I think we do have a time for one more question. I thought I saw someone who was gonna come up. Yeah.
Hey. Hello. And so I've been really interested about what you said about the question that you brought up about how everybody in the world should be vegan by 2050. I think one of the things that I've been, you know, making the connections between what you said about the intersectionality of all these different issues, about how climate change is not just about climate change, it's about access to resources, it's about poverty, it's about racism, it's about gender, it's about all these different things. And I've realized that these conversations that we've been having about veganism right now, we've been using the words like choice and decision. And I think that in those words themselves, there's a sense of privilege that you have a choice to do that. And I know you mentioned food deserts and food insecurity. And I think that's really important in this conversation.
I'm thinking, I know that this book is about the U.S. in particular, but I was thinking about, since the statistic in that quote that you gave is for a worldwide achievement goal, I'm just curious, because I was thinking about my experience last semester. I studied abroad in the Galapagos Islands. It's a really beautiful place, but I was vegan there, and I was staying like in people's homes, and I was a host. You know, they were hosting me, and I was a guest in their homes, and it was often very uncomfortable for me to ask for these things. And then we learned a lot about the economy and about how the economy, a lot of it is based on fishing, and about how what they eat is not just about the choice of what they eat. It's very, very closely connected to where they live, how much money they have, and what they can do with those combinations of privileges and oppressions. And so I'm just curious about, well, partly I was going to respond to what you said in with saying that I think that saying that we need to stop veganism in itself, you have to include in that, like, in order to do that, you have to first get rid of poverty, you know, and you have to first get rid of all these other oppressions. And so I just think that, like you said about, Alice, what you said was really interesting about how in the philosophy department, you feel kind of ostracized because not a lot of people are making those connections, that a lot of the moral reasoning that they're using in their human analysis is relevant to this conversation as well about veganism and animals. And so I don't know what my question so much is. I was just making all these connections and wanted to articulate them, but I just want to know what you think about, you know, the example I gave about these communities that rely so, like, culturally and economically on animals. Even though in an ideal world we wouldn't want that, it's inevitable, and it's got really strong historical roots as well.
Yeah, I think that's a really, really good point. And I went sort of as a kind of tangent. Yes, I think, you know, the poverty piece is so important. And also, yeah, the history of the ways that people have depended on animals for food, I see all of that. And I think we've moved so far away from that for most of us that it's really dangerous to just assume that people can choose, can make this decision. I went to the Bahamas with my husband. This was a long time ago. He's a linguist and was studying the speech patterns of a group of people who live there, who their speech is very much connected to North Carolina, weirdly enough. They're incredibly isolated. And they kept inviting us to come over and eat. And we kept saying that we had other plans. And finally, at some point, Jason said that, you know, we don't eat fish, or we don't eat turtle soup, or whatever it was that they were gonna give us, and they were incredibly offended. And it was this, you know, this moment of feeling really wrong, you know, in that decision. And yeah, it is, and I think that's one of the things I'm trying to sort of look at in here as well, but maybe not, again, in terms of the rest of the world, but who has access, and why do they have that access, and what are the reasons that other people don't? And might not want that access. And I think that's all so incredibly important and, yeah, interconnected. So, yeah.
I want to thank Alora and Alice for a really interesting conversation. Clearly, a lot more questions, a lot more stuff for us to think about. And you're going to go out front where the table was for sign up, and she'll have her books. So if you're interested in purchasing the Vegan Studies Project, you get a chance to do it right now. Anyway, thank you very, very much for coming.
Thank you so much.